Hey, everybody, how you doing? My name is Eric. I'm happy to be with you guys this morning. Why don't we all stand up today? We're going to spend some time singing some songs that we believe to reflect the deepest truths of the world, just thoughts about our God, thoughts about ourselves and our relationship to Him. And I can tell you, we're going to have a good time. People are like, wait, no, in church? No. We're going to have a good time today. Anybody come to church want to have a good time? Okay, good. If you want to feel bad about yourself, that's that other church down the road. This is the feel-good church this morning. All right. Elizabeth's going to lead us through this first tune, and we just invite you guys to enter in and lean into this God of love and grace and goodness who is so happy to see every one of your faces this morning. All right, let's do this.
Yeah.
We're going to continue to worship. We're going to sing this song that just has this old word. The word is Hosanna. The word means God save. God save now. And I think when I think of this song, when I think of that word, to me it's a great reminder of the truth of my life anyway, is that I cannot save myself. I need someone bigger, someone more loving, someone more compassionate, someone more faithful than me. And so when I come into a space and I remember who I am and who God is, it's very easy for me to say, God save me now, please. And the good news is he responds every time. He responds every time. And so out of gratitude and thanks, let's sing this morning. I see the King of Glory.
Thank you.
my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. How many of you guys know this song pretty well? All right, I expect great things out of you this morning. Let's sing this song, maybe a little bit different than how you know it. You can clap your hands if you have something you're part of, you're comfortable doing in church. This side seems like they're pretty comfortable. This side, not so sure. God is not going to strike you dead for clapping, only if you clap off rhythm. I'm kidding. All right, let's sing this. Whoa! I see. shall bow.
Heart and lead me to the Lord, to those
life.
And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
If you caught those words, that's a very pretty song with some very challenging words. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you, and I will not be shaken. I will go ahead and take a chance and say, those are hard words for me sometimes. But the truth of the matter is, with my life, is my trust gets shaken an awful lot. It's hard to live a life of faith, isn't it? Thank you. Thank you for somebody saying that. But it's a life that God calls me to and calls us to. And the first part of that bridge or that lyric, I don't want to blow by, because it says God's love is a firm foundation. Not his holiness, not his power, not his ability to create anything out of nothing. His love is the foundation. So when I screw up, and believe me, I screw up, when I fail to live that life of faith, I just look at that foundation underneath me of God's love. I don't understand it. I don't understand love like that. I've seldom had love like that in my life. But this God that I'm getting to know and continue to run after just says, hey, love is the foundation. Walk in it. If you stumble, fall on it. It's strong enough to hold you. So I don't know where you are today. Sorry for the extra speech. But I think it's too important in general to just acknowledge sometime with some honesty. Faith life is hard. But God's love is always there to catch us when we fall. And I'm grateful for that. So, let's maybe, I don't know if we do this, you guys do this normally, but can we just make some noise as a praise offering to God? Not for us, but just say, God, you're awesome.
Well, good morning, Hope. Good morning. Welcome to those of you joining us online, those of you that are new here, so glad that you are here today. Excited to tell you that today we actually sent out our first serving trip. Our students left this morning at like 5:45 a.m., all right? They got here at 5, loaded up a couple vans, and they headed on a 9-hour drive to Kentucky. And they're going to be there all week serving, building homes, and we're really excited. We've got some pictures, I think, that we can show you of them kind of getting ready and loaded up and getting on the buses. At the end, we took a group picture, and I just said, you know, point to the person you're most excited to be with on this trip. And a lot of them pointed to themselves, you know. I think some pointed to God, I think. And so you can see here, though, it's a fun group, and they left. They're still on the road. And before they left, we prayed together, and I just told them, I said, hey, our church is going to be praying for you. For some of them, actually for many of them, this is the first time they're going on a trip like this for this long. You know, given the pandemic, a lot of them have not been on a serving trip away from home for a week. And so it was a mixture of like nerves and excitement. And I just said, hey, we'll pray for you this morning. And then I'm going to ask the church to just be praying for you all week long. And what I'd love to do now is just actually do that, pray for them. So would you bow your heads with me? Let's pray. God, first, thank you for just being able to be here together, to be able to worship you this morning together. And God, thank you for the faith of these students who took a risk, who just acted with some courage to actually take a step to go on this trip. And God, we're so grateful for them. We're grateful for the leaders that are going with them and have been so supportive of them. And as they go out, God, we know there's just a mixture of some anxiety, some nerves, and some excitement. And we pray this morning, would they sense your presence with them? God, would you calm their nerves? Would they sense your peace? God, we pray for the week ahead. We pray for safe travels, for safety at their work sites. We pray that they'd get good rest and that they'd stay healthy. But God, we pray that they would meet you, that they would experience you this week. We pray that through the relationships they build with each other and the people at these sites, God, would you just grow their hearts for you and for your people? God, might they just sense you with them? Might they hear you speak to them in new ways? And God, we just pray that we'd get to hear great stories when they come back of how you've been at work. And God, we're just grateful for this group of students. Would you go before them? Would you bless them? And God, we look forward to what you're going to do. It's in the name of Christ that we pray. Amen. Amen. So yes, please do be praying for them this week. They'll be back next Saturday night. Again, can't wait to hear from them when they're back. Now, this time of the service, I'd love to give you a few minutes to get to know some people around you. So what I'd love for you to do is find someone you maybe haven't met before, introduce yourself, and let them know if you've ever been on a trip like this. And if not, who would you take with you if you could go? And then we'll come back together in a few minutes.
Yeah, go ahead, and if you would, finish those up and sit down, and we'll continue on in our service. Welcome those of you watching from home. So glad you're here with us online. And again, if you're new to our church, we're so glad you're here. Hopefully you have a great experience. We're in the Old Testament in our teaching series. We're in 1 Kings, and in a minute we'll be teaching from 1 Kings 18. But a little background, when really, kind of the precursor to this church during the pandemic was our family, the four of us. We called it home church. Every Sunday, we try watching online, and it wasn't working. And so the four of us kind of just started a little church, the four of us, during this. And we'd go one chapter each Sunday, pass the Bible, everyone read a verse, pass it around. We'd kind of unpack it, and about like the third or fourth week, We hit one of those passages in the Bible that has like a hard passage. You know what I'm talking about? You ever have that where you read the Bible like, ooh, let's just skip that one and read the fun one? There's certain stories in the Bible that you get to, like, okay, that stuff. Usually it involves some kind of death, right? My kids, this one, that Sunday, they went through it and then they said, hey, we've never heard this story before. Both kids said it. My wife said, well, I've never heard a sermon on it before. My kids turned to me and said, you're the only pastor we've known, so why is that, Dad? And I told them the truth, because I'm a chicken. I don't want to deal with that. Who wants to? And our kids said, well, if you're going to ask us to read the Bible, it really would help if you would not ignore those, but actually preach them sometimes. And so as a church, actually talking to some of you, we heard the same thing from you. Like, we don't want to just hear the easy passages, but don't be afraid of the tough ones. We're adults. We can hear it. So today, you're getting one of the tough ones. All right. Okay, good. Yes. So I say that because, number one, lots of grace. Two, pay attention. Three, trigger warning. All seriousness, for you to understand this passage, we've got to talk about some things that could be triggering. I will deal with it as best I can, sensitively and gently, but it's a little heavier, okay? So here's 1 Kings 18. Background on this, again, is the kingdom of Israel split into two. There's a northern kingdom and a southern kingdom. 12 tribes of Israel split. 10 tribes went to the north, 2 went to the south. The king of the north, a guy named Ahab, who we'll study, Bible lists him as the worst king yet. Not something you want the Bible to say about you, right? Worst one. He marries a queen named Jezebel, and together, to really build up his political power, he abandons the faith of his forefathers, the God of Israel, and he imports from Phoenicia, he imports a god named Baal. And this is a polytheistic faith. If you think about the ancient world, again, in our world, the dominant faith are all monotheistic. In fact, majority of the world traces back to Abraham and is calling God. But in this time, Elijah, who we'll study, this is about 1,000 years before Jesus, so 3,000 years ago, the world is not primarily monotheistic, it is polytheistic. The world is dominated by the gods that we would call mythology. This is the ancient gods of the Romans, the Greeks, and many others. The Phoenicians, their main god, their version of maybe Ra, is Baal. He's the god of water, rain. So you think about it, the ancient gods, you have to understand this, the polytheistic faith in the ancient world is a man-invented faith to help you understand and deal with the complexities of life. And so if you were afraid of water but had to go on a boat, it would be helpful to you to pray to the god of the water, hey, help us with this. Same thing, if you owned a farm in a desert area like the Middle East and there's not rain, it would help to go to Baal to request, hey, could you help us with this? Now, here's what you need to know about Baal. Baal, again, a god of rain and weather. Practice of Baal, the religious practice is you would pray to him, but he may not pay attention. And so then you would up your game. You might shout to him. You might even do a dance for him. You might self-mutilate, hurt yourself. Even there was the sacrificing of your own children. So that's this religion. Again, trigger alert. This is the polytheistic faith. This is that mythology that this king imports so that he can have more power over his people, okay? Last week we shared, Elijah comes onto the scene when this guy's doing it, confronts him and says, you're importing a god of rain. It will not rain now until I say so. So he's basically putting his god to the test. For 3+ years, it does not rain. 3+ years. Elijah suffers with it. He eventually goes to another country, but still is suffering through it. And you get the sense that Elijah does not know what's happening in that northern kingdom. He's just waiting for God to tell him it's time to tell him it'll rain again. Which brings us to chapter 18, verse 1. Here it says, after a long time, in the third year, the word of the Lord came to Elijah. This is God prompted him. He told him, go and present yourself to Ahab, and I will send rain on the land. Go and show up, say, Ahab, here I am. It's going to rain now. You got to imagine the emotions that Elijah was feeling. After 3 years of no rain, drought, famine, hunger, suffering, finally it's going to rain again. What might have triggered this, right? Why is God all of a sudden saying it'll rain? Is it possible there's been like a faith renewal? Is it possible that Ahab has abandoned Baal and has committed his life back to the God of Israel? Maybe. You almost get a sense maybe that things are better. So Elijah leaves and goes to meet Ahab. But on the way, he runs into a friend. And his friend delivers the bad news. It isn't better. In fact, it's worse. In the time Elijah's been gone, Jezebel, the queen, has enacted a work to kill all of the prophets of Israel. Many of Elijah's friends and co-laborers have been put to death while he's been away. And in fact, he'll discover he's getting blamed for the drought. He was trying to tell them it's the other guy's fault, but now he's getting blamed. Can you imagine? So Elijah, as disappointed he is, continues on. Here's what it says. He goes to Ahab and says, when Ahab the king saw Elijah the prophet, he said to him, is that you, you troubler of Israel? Pause for a second. This is classic narcissism. Here's a leader who's seen everything through the lens of his success. He's the hero. So if there's a problem, it can't be his fault. It must be Elijah. Do you see it? Elijah, this is your fault. If only you'd fall in line with me, this would all be good. Elijah's response, I have not made trouble for Israel, but you have, you and your father's family. You abandoned the Lord's commands and have followed the Baals. Now, summon the people from all over Israel to meet me on Mount Carmel and bring the 450 prophets of Baal. Elijah goes, it's not my fault, it's yours. Elijah, I gotta imagine the heartbreak. He's like, I told you the whole point of this was to prove your God is a fraud. That was the whole point, is that your God of rain can't produce rain, and instead you're blaming me. So Elijah calls a showdown. We're gonna meet on Mount Carmel. I want you to show up. I want all the people of this northern kingdom to show up, and I want all 450 prophets of Baal. We're gonna just have a showdown on Mount Carmel. Now, little lesson. Mount Carmel, this is home field advantage for the Baals. Home field advantage, you know what that is, right? Home field advantage is like you get to play in your house, in your stadium with your crowd. You have an advantage because everyone's on your side. Mount Carmel is where the worship of Baal is centered. If Elijah wanted to, he could have said Mount Sinai, and that would have been his home field advantage. But what you're gonna see from Elijah is he wants to demonstrate to everyone he's giving every advantage to this fake faith, so there's no excuses. So he goes, I'll meet you on your home turf, Mount Carmel. Bring them all. We're gonna have a showdown. Here's what it says. So Ahab sent word throughout the entire kingdom, king's orders, all of his kingdom. Assemble the prophets on Mount Carmel and get everybody there. And Elijah there went before the people. He basically goes not to the prophets, but to the individuals of the northern kingdom, the Jewish people. He goes to the people, says, how long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord's God, follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him. How'd the people respond? They said nothing. As quiet as this room. That word waver, basically he confronts them. It says, how long will you hop between the two? It seems like Elijah's talking about the dance that the prophets of Baal would do to get his attention. There's an ancient dance, you'll see it later, that if their prayers weren't working, they would do a dance. Now, all week I've been practicing this for you, but this morning my legs are a little sore. Basically, he's saying you're on the fence. You got one foot devoted to the God of Abraham, and you got another foot devoted to this polytheistic faith, man-made faith. Pick, which one's it gonna be? And they didn't answer. See, the thing Elijah's asking for in this moment is just make up your mind. Don't sit on the fence one way or the other. Don't be half-hearted. Don't be half-committed. Full commitment one way or the other. Nothing. Elijah's like, that's what I thought. That's what I thought. So Elijah then says to them, continuing back into this passage, then Elijah says to them, I'm the only one left of the Lord's prophets. But Baal, the other side, has 450 prophets. We're gonna do a God competition, he's saying. Get two bulls for us. Let the Baal's prophets choose one, and then they'll cut it into pieces, put it on wood, but do not set fire to it. And then I'll prepare another bull, put it on wood, and I won't set fire to mine either. Then you, the Baals, will call on your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord, and the God who answers by fire is God. And Elijah goes, how's that sound, everybody? And they said, that sounds good. Basically, he's like, we're gonna have a God competition. Isn't that fun? We're going to set up a barbecue, basically, and we're going to set up some wood and an altar, and I'll set one up, and you get to go first. Again, he's going to give the prophets of Baal the first try at it. They can pick everything first. He's trying to show this isn't a trick. I'm going to give you every advantage. We're in your home court, right? You're going to pray, and I'll give you as much time as you want, and we'll see if your God answers. And then I'm going to pray, and we'll see if my God answers. And whichever one answers, that's the true God, right? Putting God to the test. How will this play out? Here's what the story says. Then they, these are the prophets of Baal, they called on the name of Baal from morning till noon, 3 hours. Baal, answer us, they shouted. But there was no response. No one answered. So then they escalated things and they danced around the altar. They hopped around back and forth, like I said. And at noon, as they're dancing, this is where Elijah gets a sense of humor. At noon, Elijah begins to taunt them. Didn't Elijah's mom say only taunt people when, like, one against 450 is a terrible idea? Elijah, be a little smarter. This is very scary. Elijah taunts them. Shout louder, he says. Surely he's a god. Perhaps he's deep in thought. Or maybe he's busy. Or maybe he's traveling. Maybe he's asleep and he's just got to be awakened. Can you imagine? All right, so a couple things. Elijah's mocking him, but all the things he said are actually captured in ancient literature about Baal. They found this. They've seen this. Baal, again, is a man-made god. He's invented by human beings. And so when he doesn't answer prayer, they assume, just like a human, he's got excuses. He must be busy. That actually means he's going to the bathroom. He's on the toilet. You can't bug him. When it says he's traveling, one of the ancient stories, they couldn't get in touch with Baal because he was out on a hunting trip. One of the most frequent is Baal appears to be a heavy sleeper in ancient literature. So frequently, he has to be roused, some of the times by the other gods, because he's just in such deep sleep. Comical, right? This is why he's making fun of their god. And this is why in the faith of Baal, you have to understand this, they escalate from prayers, then to shouting, then to dancing, and then to even more extreme things. Which is where this goes. They've now been doing this for 3 hours. They've gotten to the place of dancing. Nothing's happening. Can you imagine their feelings? This would be very embarrassing. We somehow can't get a miracle to happen. So the next thing they do, and again, trigger warning, the Bible captures, they start to self-harm. They start to hurt their own bodies in the hopes that their sacrifice of themselves will get their fake God's attention. And nothing happens. It says midday passed, coming back to the Bible. Midday passed, so they're past noon, past the middle of the day, into the afternoon, and they continued their frantic prophesying until the time for the evening sacrifice, sun's starting to set. They did all day long. You got to give them credit. They gave a great effort, but there was no response. No one answered. No one paid attention. There was no God to respond, right? Then Elijah stepped forward. Elijah said to all the people, I love this. He goes, come here. Come closer. Basically, if you can imagine the trauma of what they've just witnessed, this would be a long day. He's like, let's just you and me now. Come on. He brings up nice and close, says, come closer. And then he says this. They came to him and he repaired the altar of the Lord. Translation, somebody tore it down. As they were killing prophets, they also set about to destroy anything that was a religious site for the Jewish faith. They tore it down. So Elijah repairs it. The translation may be even better. He healed the altar, which had been torn down. He took 12 stones, one for each of the tribes descended from Jacob. Don't miss it. That's a political statement. He's only speaking to 10. They're at odds with the other two. He grabs 12. He's making it real clear. This God that we serve, it's not just one nation or the other nation. It's our family's God. He's always been the God of all 12. We don't separate. We might have our differences, but he's the God of the 12. Puts these 12 stones out. Says this isn't just one person's faith. This is our faith. Took the 12, one for each of the tribes to whom the word of the Lord had come, saying, your name shall be Israel. With the stones, he built the altar, and then he began to dig a trench around it. I love this. One of the great lessons of this is there are times in our own lives where our faith needs a little healing as well. Some of the times you can build up your life of faith, but through erosion or neglect, that aspect of your faith can be torn down. And sometimes you need, much like Elijah, to put everything back together. Elijah builds the altar. He digs a trench out front. What's he going to do with that trench? Here's what it says. Then he said to them all, fill four large jugs with water and pour it on top of the offering. He pours all this water on top of both the meat he's laid out and the wood. He does it once and he says, do it again. They did it again, filled up the jug. Do it a third time, he ordered, and they did it a third time. And the water was so intense it ran down the altar, and that trench he had dug, he used it to catch all the water. So you now have this massive amount of water, both on the wood, on the meat, and all around in front. Time out. Has Elijah never built a fire before? Like, the whole point is for God's fire to come down. Everybody knows you want wood that's dry, right? What's happening here? Two sides. There's the surface level, then there's a much deeper message. On the surface side, once again, what Elijah's trying to do is to show it's not a trick. It's why he had them do it. He didn't do it himself. He wanted every person who picked up a jug to be able to say, it was water, I saw it. He wants evidence. Two, he didn't want it to be easy. He wants God to prove himself. And by the way, it's God. You don't think he can burn through water, right? That's the surface level. He wants to do something so miraculous. They walked around. It had to be God. That's the surface. On the deeper level, let me ask you, do you remember, what's the God Baal? What's he God of? Water. So he just covered this in the substance that Baal is supposed to have dominion over. He wants to make it crystal clear. Our God is real. That one is a fraud. You know what's going to happen. Elijah stepped forward and prayed, Lord, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you are God in Israel and that I am your servant and I have done all these things at your command. Answer me, Lord, answer me, so that these people will know you are Lord, you are God, and that you are turning their hearts back again. I love this. Pause there. They just witnessed all day long chanting, shouting, dancing, all sorts of things to try to get God's attention. Elijah just sits down and just says, hey, real humbly, just me and you. It's such a conversational prayer, isn't it? Hey, God, it's me. Here's what I'm asking you to do. Here's why I'm asking it. Let them know this. Done. Simple prayer. Bible says, immediately the fire of the Lord fell, burned up the sacrifice, the wood, the stones, the soil, and it even licked up the water in the trench. When all the people saw this, they fell prostrate and cried out, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. Isn't that beautiful? That's a moment that I hope when I get to heaven, that's one I'd like to see. Like, can we put that one on the VCR? Because I just want to watch it one time. Like, did you notice, like, he didn't just light the wood, but he burned up the wood. The stones disappeared. The soil got burned. Even it says it licked up the water. It's like God's showing off now, right? It's just showing off. And that's what he's doing. So that he could turn their hearts back. Something you notice here is God wants to be found. Did you notice this? God doesn't want to hide from you. He wants you to know him, to see him, to experience him. He wants to be found by you. In this moment, he's going to do the most miraculous thing in the hopes that their hearts will turn back to him. That's what's at stake in this, is your heart. Now, let me speak to you. The dominant metaphor for faith in the Bible, do you know what it is? It's marriage. Jesus, do you know what he calls his church? Do you know this? What's the metaphor? Is bride. The idea is, some people think this is a religion, and that's what the worship of Baal was. Actions to get a God's approval. Activities by which you would gain his favor or an answer. That is not what God is ever asking. If you thought Christianity was that, a set of actions, a set of rules, you've missed it. What it is a living God who's real, the maker of this world who designed you, who's hoping you would give your heart to him. And he's hoping you have a relationship, a marriage, if you will, for life. That's what he's hoping. That's what he was hoping from these people as well. And the thing that God doesn't want is half-hearted. Anybody, I mean, can you imagine? Can you imagine, those of you who are married, if someone asked you, or if you asked someone to marry you, say, hey, I love you, I want to spend the rest of my life, will you marry me? And the person said, okay. Like, that wouldn't be a good response, right? That is not the response I'd be looking for. God's the same way. This is part of what he's saying. He isn't looking for someone to go, sure. He's looking for someone to go, oh, I'll devote myself to you just as you've devoted yourself to me. That's what he's looking for. And this passage, what it acknowledges is when Elijah prays that prayer about their hearts, he acknowledges the heart has a tendency to wander. It doesn't stay stagnant or still. It moves. And those of you who've been married a long time, I'm guessing you know this. There are times where you feel closer to the other. Sometimes you feel further away. It kind of has this tendency to move, which is why as married couples, you have to be attentive to that. You've got to prioritize date nights, conversations, learning about each other, activities that you enjoy together, things to keep your hearts united, because if you're not careful, you can become separated from each other. God wants you, in the same way, if you're a believer in him, to have a heart that's devoted to him for life. But some of the times the heart wanders. And the key then is that you recognize my heart's a little farther from God, and you almost have a recommitment ceremony. You know what I mean? Just you and God, where you go, hey, I wanna come back. And the Bible describes that time and time again. Someone wanders away, and God's invitation is come back, come back. That's what God is doing here. In this miracle moment, what he's saying to the entire crowd is, come back. Remember, you already committed yourself to me. Come back. Come back, I'll forgive this, but come back. What God's most concerned with isn't your religion or your sacrifice or your giving. It's your heart. It's your heart. The people saw this amazing moment and they declared, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. Now here's where we get to the difficult part of this passage. Are you ready for it? Do you know the difficult part? Are you falling asleep already? No? Okay. The difficult part of this passage is there's this incredible moment. They see a miracle happen. It's beyond comprehension. They know it's a miracle. They then declare their hearts back with God. And then Elijah turns to them and says, those 450 prophets of Baal, they have to die. And so they kill all 450 prophets of Baal there that day. That is the really difficult thing in this passage. Why pastors, many of us, we stop at the fire, we don't tell the rest of the story. Now, I share this because these are the ones you have to understand. How do you understand that? Let me talk you through different theological views of this, okay? Why would he do this? Okay, real quickly. Again, there's in theological terms, there's one school that says what these prophets had done was they led the people astray, and the Old Testament makes it clear, false prophets, that is a death sentence in Israel. You do not get to deceive people about God and lead their hearts away from God. That there's a punishment for that, number one. Number two, they also likely were the ones who carried out the murder of God's prophets, and the Bible's also clear the people of Israel were to care for the prophets, not kill them, obviously. So there's that as well. And so if you look at it, the question is, was he justified in doing this or was this sin? There's one school of thought that says he was justified because what they had done was wrong. There's a second school that says he, one person, Elijah, was justified, but, and they acknowledge this, religious zeal, which Elijah will use that phrase three times, that he was zealous for the Lord. Religious zeal oftentimes carries individuals into very dangerous moral grounds. Read through history, and people who claim zealousness for all different faiths have done horrific deeds. And so a whole other group of theologians say, Elijah was justified as one of the most holy people. He only did this one time. He was the only person who stood for God, and he was in front of the whole nation to save the nation. That's it. And there's a third group. And this is from the Christian perspective, that if you read the Old Testament to New, there is an arc of understanding as God is making his will known and understood. And in this ancient world, Elijah carries out of his zeal a willingness to kill those. But when you move to the New Testament, Jesus Christ, out of his zeal, has a different take, that he isn't willing to kill, but he's willing to die for those. If you remember at the very end, Peter, filled with zeal to protect Jesus, cut off the ear of someone, and Jesus stopped him. You know the story? Jesus stopped and said, Peter, you got it all wrong. And he healed that person's ear. He's like, that's not the path my people are on. Okay in the past, but this is not who we are. We are going to have the zealousness to forgive, to suffer, die if we have to, but not to take another life. My interpretation is very difficult. It comes down to Elijah's prayer. Do you remember what he prayed? In it, he said this, let it be known today that you are God in Israel, that's clear, and that I'm your servant and I have done all these things at your command. But my best sense is there's more to Elijah's prayer life and commands than we know. And I think God made it clear he had had enough of a polytheistic faith that demanded such horrific deeds as the sacrifice of children. He was done with that. Micah, can't remember if I gave this verse to you guys or the last service, but I might have repeated myself. One of the verses I hear of people our generation love is from Micah. I even have a mug on it. It says this. It says, what does God require? Do you know this? Love justice, love mercy, and what? Walk humbly with my God, right? Love justice, love mercy, walk humbly with your God. What does God require? Love justice, love mercy, walk humbly with our God. It's a beautiful verse, right? What's the verse just before that one? Micah describes that there's religions of that day that think what God asks for is the sacrifice of their children. See, we don't live in a world like that, but they did. Micah, one of the contemporaries just around that same time of Elijah, a prophet, was saying, God doesn't want this kind of behavior. What does he want? Not that kind of sacrifice. Love justice. Love mercy. Walk humbly. You get the sense God had had enough of these kinds of faiths that were demanding things that he did not want, and he was working to put an end to it. And history tells us the worship of Baal ended not long after this event of the story. That's how I interpret it. You, as you read it, will have to find your interpretation. That's the beauty of the gap. Make sense? Okay. Now, what do you do with this? Number one. Can I just ask you, what's the state of your heart to this God? Those of you who are Christians, if your connection to God, if the analogy is a marriage, how's your marriage doing? Do you need a marriage retreat? Do you need some counseling? how are you doing? Do you need time with God? Do you need reconnection? Do you need to recommit your heart? Has your heart wandered? This passage is a great one to just do a quick heart checkup. How's the relationship, number one? Two, are you on the fence? Is your heart kind of torn about which God you'll serve? And obviously we don't have a polytheistic faith, but do you have clarity on who is God? Maybe are you in the search and you need to make up your mind? What I love in this story, again, is God will show up for you exactly what you need. Some of you, if you're not sure about God, you need to start praying a bold prayer. God, show up in a way that I'll know it's you, in a way that I can understand, and trust that he'll do that. But you just pray that prayer every day until he shows up for you. But my hope as we as a church is that we encourage each other to make sure our hearts haven't wandered. We encourage each other to make sure that our hearts are fully his. We encourage each other to make sure that we're reading, we're studying, we're trying to live this out. And if there's any error in our ways, we ask God, correct us. Yes? Okay. Let me pray for us, can I? God, this is my prayer out of this passage. Yeah, God, this is my prayer. God, might we be a people devoted to you, honest and sincere. God, might we actually seek to understand every page of the Bible, understand what it's saying so that we can apply it to our lives, not ignoring parts. God, would you teach us your ways? God, ultimately, might the zeal we have match that of Christ, willing to sacrifice for you, willing to forgive those who've hurt us, willing to love those, take those back in, showing mercy. God, I do ask, there's some in this room who they're not sure about you. They're on the fence. They've got doubt. God, I would just ask you, show up for them so clearly they'd know it's you. That you'd woo them to yourself with your love and your grace for them. That you as the maker of them and of this world, that they'd sense you're here right now. They don't have to get your attention. They don't have to do anything. You're constantly paying attention. And God, might we be marked as people aware of your presence, filled with your love, and seeking to care for our world. God, that's our prayer. We pray this in the name of Christ. Amen. 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 Well, thanks again for being here. We've got one last piece. Yeah. Thanks. We got one last piece of our service. Gina, come up. We're going to do just announcements, some next steps.
That's good. All right. Some things coming up that I want to make sure you know about. This Tuesday, we have a summer cookout here at the church, and it's just a time with community. We'll have food here, activities inside the gym and outside as well for the whole family, and so hope you can join us for that. You can, if you could RSVP, that'll just help us plan for food. You can go to our website, hopecommunity.net, scroll down to the bottom. It says summer cookout. Just click on that. It'll take you 2 seconds, or if you don't want to do that, those of you here in the room, you can just stop by one of the tables outside. I'll let them know that you want to join us for that. We hope that you'll be there for that. One little caveat with that is, you know, Chicago weather. Right now, it looks like there's a little bit of a chance of rain, and so we're going to keep an eye on that. We'll send out an email like Tuesday afternoon just confirming all the plans. If you're not signed up for our weekly email, in the seat in front of you, there's a QR code on a card. Just scan that. You can sign up, and that way, every week, you'll get an email with everything that's happening here around the church. And I'd love for you to do that. If you're watching online, you can go to our website and sign up for the weekly e-news that way. A second, we have a college study, that's Bible study, that's going to happen this summer here at the church on Wednesday evenings, and it starts in a couple weeks on June 21st. If you know someone, or if you are someone that's college age, graduated from high school all the way through college, like 23 or so, love to have you at the study. It's going to be a time, again, just to get to know other students of the same age, go through a book of the Bible together here on Wednesday nights, and so hope you'll sign up for that. You can do that on the website as well. If you came prepared to give an offering today, there's a box in the back of the room. You can also give online at our website. And the very last thing I want to ask is, this week we have this cookout, hopefully it's going to happen Tuesday night, and we're going to open up the gym for all kinds of activities and sports. And so what we need to do is we actually need to clear this gym and stack chairs. So if you are able, if you've got backaches, don't worry about it, okay? Look for somebody that looks like they want to stack chairs and give them yours. But if you could stack them in stacks of 8 before you head out of here, that'd really help us out a lot in getting the gym ready for Tuesday night. Thank you so much for being here today. I hope you have a wonderful week, and we'll see you next weekend, everyone.